Stop before the hand is
fell. Yeah, just do this part. Oh, and then that. You can do that part.
Okay. All right.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to East Orrington Congregational Church. I'd like to remind everyone that today, after service, we'll be offering coffee fellowship downstairs. Everyone is invited to attend. It's a great place to meet old friends, make new friends, and everyone is encouraged to come. Also, we remind you there are white cards in each pew you can fill out for multiple reasons. If it is your first time here, we'd love to hear from you. Or if you'd like to have prayers lifted up during the week, or possibly a visit from a member or Pastor Carl, the cards are the easiest way to get in touch. For those of you who are new to our church, there are hymnals under the pews for your use. Now I think Betty is going to... There she is.
Good morning. I'm representing Compassion International, which is it's a child sponsorship program in 25 countries in Africa, the Caribbean, Latin America, South America, and Asia. It's a program that children go to a church. They have a safe place to play. Their health is monitored. They receive nutritional meals. They get help with their homework. They're taught, for example, to wash their hands before they eat, to brush their teeth, and that sort of thing. It's a one-on-one sponsorship program, which means if you sponsor a child, you are the only sponsor for that child. That child will write to you, you'll receive pictures, you can write to the child, you can send little items like stickers or pictures of your family, your animals, or whatever like that. It's $38 a month, which is like $1.27 a day. Changes a child's life. Downstairs, I have a table with lots of children who need sponsors. So afterwards, I hope you'll meet me at the table. I can answer your questions and so forth. Donna chose a child last year, so she's going to share a little bit about that.
Morning. I know the picture's too small. I'll put it downstairs on the table with Betty. But you get letters like these, and this little boy sends me a picture. He always colors a picture on the back. His name, I can't pronounce his name, but the name on here is Isaiah. When I started, he was 3 years old. He's now five. He is tutored, and he's going into first grade next year. He's been in kindergarten. So it's very worthwhile to do this for a child because they send you letters that say what they do in school, about their health. They have helped people rewrite the letters, like his father is a missionary, and he says he just wants people to know Christ and Jesus. And so it's very worthwhile.
What country is he in?
Indonesia.
Indonesia.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have a video, and we'll see that next. And I just want to thank you for your attention. And please consider sponsoring a child and changing a child's life really for eternity. It's a church-based program. They have a pastor. They have a Sunday school to go to. And these are the poorest children of the community, and they're invited in to take part in this program. They get some vocational training so they can actually do a job. One girl that we sponsored was learning sewing. So she can sew her own clothes, she can sew clothes for the neighbors and have an income. So see us down at the table and I'll answer your questions and we'll watch the video. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
It was lunchtime, and my father was praying for the lunch that we were about to eat. But there was only one problem. Our table was empty.
My earliest recollections is finding myself at the age of 5, roaming the streets, eating from dumpsters.
We were not able to have food at all, at all.
We were forced to live with 17 of our other relatives in a very small shanty.
No toilets.
A lot of crime.
No running water.
There's a lot of rape for children.
If you want to be out of poverty, then you have to deal with drugs.
Some of my friends were actually sold into prostitution.
And as darkness engulfs the place, the devil takes over.
One morning, I just woke up that, you know, my uncle is just touching me in some parts of my body that I just thought to myself that this can't be happening.
My father was murdered right next to my mother. And I knew that moment that my life had changed.
I watched as my 10-month-old sister died in the laps of my mother out of starvation.
My relatives always tell me, Michelle, you are so ugly. You look exactly like your father. You will become nothing but a thief and a drug addict when you grow up. And those were the words that I heard from people whom I expected to love and take care of me.
Poverty had told me I am hopeless, I am nothing, and I believed that. But right in the middle of this desperation, it was then that compassion intervened.
One Sunday morning, my Aunt Carol, she registered me in that compassion project.
What joy and dancing came to my home at the news that I'd finally got a sponsor.
I received my first letter.
We wrote back and forth.
They told me, you're my first friend outside my continent.
She said words like, Richmond, I love you.
And that lightened me up.
When my sponsor told me that, Michelle, you are beautiful, you are precious to us, we are proud of you, and we are praying for you, and we love you. And their words touched the very depth of my heart and soul.
Here I am, a child rescued from hopelessness.
She was 15 years old. Her name is Ashley.
Her name was Heather. I called her mom.
One act saved my life.
Saved my life.
Will you act?
The choice is yours.
Sponsor a child through compassion today.
Release a child from poverty.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
For 5 years, and it has been very rewarding to me to know that I have given her a chance at life and a chance to know God. Another announcement, Families of Women's Fellowship will be Wednesday, October 23rd this month. Change from, I believe, Tuesday to Wednesday for this month. There'll be a meeting, refreshments, and a surprise event. They will be meeting in the boardroom at 1:30 in the afternoon.
I'm going to jump in for one quick second. Sure. I didn't want to have the day go by without me mentioning to you. A lot of times we, with our kids and other things, we try to let people know the things that they have done, the wonderful things that sometimes go under unnoticed. There's two things that's happened to me on this past weekend. One was Saturday morning. We got the opportunity to move the Richardsons from their house of long ago. There was 11 or 12 of us that gathered together. And I say I had a great time. I had a really good time just serving with the guys of this church and one of the ladies. And so, but the second thing, what happened on Friday night, you know, we all have things that we do outside, right? I mean, we have other parts of our life. But this one gentleman, I was privileged to be invited to the Hall of Fame reception at Husson College this past Friday night, and he's going to smack me for this. But one of our own, Larry Homestead, who's one of our choir members, sits next to me, or did sit next to me, received the prestigious Presidential Award for Volunteerism. And then as I sat there and listened to him, I'm listening to these things that he has done, especially over the past few years since his wife's passing, I realized he's also been doing that for us in many ways, behind the scene things that get taken care of, or if the trustees need something. And so, you know, he was awarded at Husson University for his dedication to Husson. But, you know, he could just receive, well, and so many of you could just as well receive the Pastoral Award for volunteerism here. And so on behalf of this weekend, thank you for all of you that volunteer. But a special congratulations to Larry, as it was a special, special night. So thank you for the invitation.
Now let us take a moment, join in the right hand of Christian fellowship. Over your bulletin inserts for upcoming activities and for those on our prayer list. Now, may we prepare ourselves for worship in silent meditation as the light of Christ is brought into our house of God. Thank you.
In the world that we live, sometimes we hear the complaining and what's wrong and that type of language. One of the great things I love about my church family is that's not often heard as that is on the outside world. I hear the praises and the love that is shared. And Psalms 103 tells us that's exactly what we should do, is focus on the good, remember the good of what God has done for us. And that should lift us up. For the Lord says, it says, that let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord, and may I never forget the good things he has done for me. He forgives all my sins and heals and restores my soul. He redeems me from death and crowns me with the love and tender mercy. He fills my life. My youth is renewed like an eagle's. The Lord gives righteousness and justice to all who are treated unfairly. As we gather here this morning to celebrate, to worship our Lord and Savior, may we celebrate in the positiveness, remembering what he has done for us. For the one thing, you know, we always say what's guaranteed in life is death and taxes. And I think it's just death. But what really is guaranteed for Christians, we have been forgiven. That's the good news. And the question, do we spread that out? Is that what we live on, the good news, or do we dwell on the bad? Let us come together and worship and dwell on the good of the Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So we turn to our Lord and we pray together as a family, united through the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Gracious and holy, merciful God, Father, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for every breath we take. Lord, I am constantly reminded how valuable each breath is, how wonderful it is to give and to work together. Lord, it is wonderful, and I give you all praise and glory as men gathered yesterday, some with strong backs, and weak minds, other with weak minds and strong backs. Lord, we gathered together both those that struggled to take air and those that had no problem, but we worked together as one unit. And Lord, it was a thrill and it was an honor to serve your people in this way. Father, may we always be united and look for the good. May we be united in how we love. May we be united in how we serve you and love you, O Lord. Father, we turn to you knowing that you hear our prayers. We ask for your blessings to be upon today's message as we talk about prayer. I ask you, O Lord, to bless those that are serving this great country and our armed forces, to keep them safe, and those that they leave behind, may they have peace, knowing that you are with them as well. We pray this for every call the police or the fire departments may give. Where every call, a civil service person must go out into some stranger's home, not knowing what they're going to find. Lord, I ask for blessings upon each and every one of them. Father, I give you great thanks as this morning I was at the hospital and working with the compassionate love of nurses and the doctor and to a family that needed us. Father, I thank you for those opportunities as I witness your love and your grace. May we all praise you and give witness to what you have done for us in our lives. Lord, we pray for our families, our children, and our extended families, such as EOCC family. We pray for the other churches around the world as they too come together and praise your name. Lord, I have special prayers for my friend Wilbins down in Haiti as he is gathering at this same moment as we're on the same time zone to worship and to praise your holy name in a different way. They are praising without a roof, but they now have a floor. Praise be to God. Lord, we give you thanks for the opportunity to have the missions abound in this church. Ones we heard last week, the compassion mission of today, OCC last night, Lord, and the list goes on and on. Father, bless this church and its ministries. Bless the missions we support and the missions other churches support. Father, be with us as we journey through this thing called life.
Father, at this time, we take a moment and we turn to you in a time of silent prayer, lifting up our own joys and concerns. Gracious God, hear our prayers. Lord, we pray for the upcoming state meeting next Saturday. May it be well attended, and may we gain and glean from this. Lord, I pray for this church and its leadership and all the volunteerism that goes in. Lord, I give you thanks for that. I thanks and ask your blessings that be upon each person, but each of the different boards that we support and that supports your church here at East Orrington. Lord God, we walk, and we know you journey with us. You pick us up when we need to be picked up, but you also call each of us to do the same, to lift each other up, to remind them of the goodness of what you have blessed us with. And if necessary at times, O Lord, speak. Father, bless us as we turn to your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, our Father.
Number 266, the hymnals can be found under your pew, is Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling.
Thank you.
other times
you hear during offertory and other times when I say that your gifts do more than what you sometimes will be aware of, what you know. This past week, if you drove by the church on Tuesday and then in all day Wednesday, you might have noticed a large tractor trailer truck parked up here. Well, with what happened, Jim, did you have that concern? I see you laughing. Okay. So we had the tractor trailer parked up here. What happened is he was going to deliver a load down at Crescent Lumber, but on his transporting here, the load shifted. Actually, the bundles that were there, it was all vinyl siding, long things of vinyl siding, and they collapsed and threw his load off kilter, but all the boxes broke open, and it was a mess. Well, Crescent refused the delivery because it's too dangerous for anybody to unload it because you never know what was going to happen. So he came up here and asked if he could just park it, which he did, until he got help. So they had to hire a company to come up, and they unloaded the whole truck and stuff, and he expected to be out of there Wednesday mid-afternoon. Well, the company didn't even show up until after 4 o'clock. So those that came for choir, this is the rest of the story that you guys saw. They brought these lights and all this stuff, and they had to unload the whole truck piece by piece. All this lumber, they had to rebuild all the crates and everything. I mean, it was quite the project. But we left here about 8:15 or 8:30, whatever time our boss let us out. And I went over to the driver who's now been here for a day and a half, and I talked to him a couple other times. But I said, what time do you expect to leave? I thought you were going to leave earlier. He said, well, they have another 5 or 6 hours probably. And I think they got done about 1:30, 2 o'clock. He said, so I'm here. I can't drive because of the time. So I'm going to be here until probably tomorrow at 7-ish. So I said, well, listen. When was the last time you had a shower? I didn't want to offend him, but he's, no. So I invited him into the fellowship hall. I showed him the kitchen. I showed him the couch that we have down there. He goes, oh, I can sleep in the truck. And I reminded him, I said, well, the lifts, the forklifts are bumping the trailer and moving it. I said, how are you going to sleep in that? And he goes, well, I probably won't. So this church, because of your giving, because of our love and our openness, I believe, and I did this without hesitancy because I didn't think anybody would object to it, but I opened the doors to him. And I said, the doors are open downstairs. Use it as you want. And he did. He used the showers. He had a great sleep, he said, a quiet sleep. And when I came in and he was just leaving, everything was locked up, tidied up. You know, I told him to use the kitchen if he'd like, and I even showed him where there was a frozen turkey, but he wouldn't have time to cook it. But I did say, if you find any frozen food, and I think he had a couple freeze pops because I saw the paper in the trash can, which was wonderful. You know, because of your gifts, these are the way that we give without, a lot of times it goes under the thing like what Larry does at Husson and within this church and other people do. It's just good to know that we are giving God the glory in so many different ways, and that was just one example. And you would think I gave him $1 million on behalf of us, and in fact, what he gave me was joy. So that's how we give. And when you give with that openness and that joyfulness, knowing that these gifts go beyond these walls and beyond just the lights and the heating. It touches people in so many different ways. As I invite the ushers and the deacons for today's offertory. please. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks, and we turn to you at this very moment and ask for your continued blessings to be upon this church family, but also upon the gifts that are laid on this table. May they be multiplied to do your good works on this earth. May we be good stewards, but we also be bold and courageous, doing as you ask us to do. Father, I pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
wait a moment for the children to come in? Please join in me in reciting the unison prayer, which can be found in your pew Bible and on the screens. Lord, upon the pages of this book is your story. It is also our story. Open your eyes that we may see, our ears that we may hear, our minds that we may understand, and our hearts that they may be changed. In Jesus' name, amen. Our first reading is going to be from Habakkuk, chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, found on page 712. How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Violence is everywhere. I cry, but you do not come to save. Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all this misery? Wherever I look, I see destruction and violence. I am surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. The law has become paralyzed, and there is no justice in the courts. The wicked far outnumber the righteous, so that justice has become petrified. Second reading is from Luke, chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. It can be found on page 800. One day, Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should always pray and never give up. There was a judge in a certain city, he said, who neither feared God nor cared about people. A widow of that city came to him repeatedly, saying, "Give me justice in this dispute with my enemy." The judge ignored her for a while, but finally he said to himself, "I don't fear God or care about people, but this woman is driving me crazy. I'm going to see that she gets justice because she is wearing me out with her constant requests." Then the Lord said, "Learn a lesson from this unjust judge. Even he rendered a just decision in the end. So don't you think God will surely give justice to his chosen people who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will grant justice to them quickly. But when the Son of God Son of Man returns, how many will he find on earth who have faith?" May God bless this reading of his holy word.
First reading from Habakkuk, you could hear that things haven't changed that much. Sometimes we think in this world that we're the ones that have all the troubles and it's just this generation, but if you go back thousands of years, it was the same. He's basically asking the Lord, how long? See, how many of you sometimes think, where's the justice today? You know, that's a question that comes before most pastors' plate. And probably many of you in many different ways. It wasn't too long ago that I got a call from a young man that I didn't know, but he just wanted to talk to somebody, and he just happened to pick this church out of the hat, where I believe God led him, because I had a wonderful conversation with him. But he was a young man, probably 27, 28. His wife of 5 years left him about 9 months to a year before that, during a time period when the job that he had went out. He wasn't fired, but the job was gone. His wife was the second income, and she just up and left, went to another state, gave complete custody to him, the children, wanted nothing, two children. And this man had to go and find welfare. He had to plead for health care for his children, basic health care. He had to plead to get food on the table with food stamps, but he was also trying to go out and get a job. But you try to lug two kids under 5 years old out to every job, so he got subsidized child care. He was able to find a place for his children. He did this, and this first part, as he described to me, took almost 4 months of almost full-time work to do this. And so he's been looking for a job, and he called me because he's been working for about a month now. He found a full-time $12.50 an hour job. He was pretty happy. He was thrilled until he did what was right. He told his caseworker, and his food stamps disappeared. His subsidized child care disappeared. At first, they said that he would lose his health care for his children, which did not happen. So we praise God. But his turmoil was, where is the justice? I did everything by the book. I did everything I could, and they're taking it all away. It was better that I never found a job. So he asks, where's the justice? And then again, not too long ago, I talked to Paul Watson. Many of you remember Janet Watson, her son. He lives over in South Africa. He goes to a church there, and I talk to him every once in a while. He asked the same question in a different way. He was at a roundtable discussion group in his church, and one of the people in his discussion, they were talking about injustices of the world. And one of the people at the church said, I hate Americans. And of course, that perked Paul's ears up, and he's not rich by any means over there, but he does well with his retirement. And he goes, why would you say that? He says, do you realize right now they're probably trying to figure out what restaurant they're going to when just up the border they're trying to figure out what child they're going to save from starving to death? They don't understand. Where's the justice in this world? You know, Ray and Linda Colford are very diligent about coming on Wednesday nights, which I appreciate. And Ray almost every week asks us to pray for the hungry and the homeless, which we do. And most every week, and I'm just going to my mind today, I didn't do it, but most every week I always pray for our president and all people with power to have understanding and sensitivity to the world around them, the kindness. We pray on a continuous basis, I'm sure you do at home, for those that are suffering and the sick. And yet, for me, reading the Bangor Daily or any newspaper or turning on the news, what I see is even more chaos seems to be happening. There's more hatred. There's more killings. You know, where was the next shooting coming from? That's a question that was just recent. Why do we try if we, you know, the next one's going to happen? It's going to be bigger. And there's more and more wrong, it seems, that's in the world than there was yesterday. But I think the Old Testament proves us wrong, that this was their time period too. But the question that comes up a lot of times is, do our prayers do anything? Is there no justice in the world? Why do we pray if we're not seeing any justice happening? Have you ever asked yourself about prayer? See, I think Jesus in this passage, let's go back to Habakkuk first. His prophet, he was disturbed by the injustice that he was seeing. He was disturbed and saying, how long, O Lord, will we withstand this? How long are you going to keep injustice, allowing injustice to happen? How long will it continue, God? How long, O Lord, must we suffer as your people? And God would reply to Habakkuk that the fact that through faithfulness, the righteous will find full abundance in life in due time. There's the hard word that we have a problem with, due time. But one must wait on God to fulfill the promise. See, this is told throughout the Bible if we read the Bible carefully, that throughout the Bible it says that we must trust the Lord. We must trust in his judgment. We must trust in what he has said. We must wait for his day. This is the day that the Lord has made. We sing that sometimes, but we also must wait for the judgment to come in his time. Isaiah 40 says, for those who wait for the Lord, they shall fly on eagle's wings. You know, that's what that judgment is going to be like. So then we switch over to the gospel lesson that Betty read in Luke. And the gospel lesson for me is, again, you have to read all the stories that are leading up to this. But it talks about prayer. But I also think this is one of the big misunderstood parables for me. Again, I'm speaking only for me as I read it and I understand. I think it's very misunderstood. I think many pastors and many people, many lay people in Bible studies misinterpret this passage. Because many interpret that if we're persistent and we're constant in our prayer and we keep bugging God, God will hear us. Anybody ever hear that? That we need to bug God and then he'll answer us. Beat him down. The problem with this, in this passage especially, that if we view this, that God is the judge in this parable, he'd be simply a tyrant that we have to beat down for him to do anything for us. Because what does it say about the judge? He neither feared God or cared about people. See, and he'd just be that tyrant who we had to beat down to do anything for us. See, interpreting the parable this way does not, for me, fit with any of the teachings of Jesus Christ. That's not the God I know. He is not a tyrant. He is not a God that doesn't care about people. The point that I believe Jesus is trying to point us to by using the judge as an example is not to compare him and God, but to show us and point us to the direction of the widow. Jesus was calling us to follow her example in persistent prayer and acting out in her faith. She prayed because of her faith. Even in the face of seemingly indifference, that justice was not going to take care of itself, and continuing injustice constantly. And in closing the parable, and this is where it gets really fun, because in closing the parable, Jesus asks, will the Son of Man find faith on earth when he comes? That's a load, folks. Will he find faith when he comes? The parable is not a picture of how God acts. It's a picture how we are, as Christians, are supposed to act in faith. How we're supposed to live our faith. Not just say it, but live it. And I think so many people, so many Christians misunderstand prayer. And this passage for me kind of puts prayer where I can understand it better. Well, where I understand it through Scripture better. See, I think we are to live our faith, and this parable is telling us that, as we wait for God's completion of history, when the true judge, the one and only judge, returns. I believe Jesus uses the widow, basically, who is at the bottom of the food chain in power, to show us that the impossible is possible. That through faith, we need to keep working and keep talking and keep doing, even if the right answer isn't coming about. See, this widow was persistent because she was praying, but she didn't receive an answer. Anybody ever pray and didn't get the answer for a while? And we give up praying? Or we say, what's the heck? See, this is this passage that answers that question that we sometimes have trouble with. It is an answer that tells us, first of all, if we read Scripture, God is nothing like this judge. God cares for us. I believe that with all my heart. God is concerned about justice. But the hard part about this God is concerned about justice part, the hard part is, and the challenging part is, God wants us to carry out the justice for him. The justice that God wants to give needs to be carried out by us. God is calling us to love and to do as Christ had done. Luke introduces Jesus' parable here by saying that this story is about how we should pray. How we should pray, even when things aren't going, when every kind of power or injustice is against us, that we need to continue to pray. Not to bug Jesus, God, to change his mind. We just need, even when it seems like God is not hearing us, that we need to continue to pray. And that's where I want to go to. Because I need us to understand what is prayer. There was a wonderful book, and in it was a little section about Desmond Tutu. And most of you know that he was the Archbishop of South Africa after a point of time. But it tells us in this book, when he was a younger person, younger, like in his late teens, early 20s, that the poverty and the injustices and the suffering his people were suffering around him, that he went to his pastor and said, "Why is this happening? Why is this happening? Why doesn't God do something about it?" See, we've all heard that question, right? And I love the response the minister gives according to Desmond. The minister responded, "He has done something. He created you." What a response. Again, that gives me goosebumps every time I think of that. He created you. Desmond Tutu became the answer to his own question. Why doesn't God do something? He has. He created us. But we don't like that answer. See, while we're waiting for God to bring about this perfect justice and all the answers to the world, we are being called, like a book, to respond to God, to be the answer that we seek. God is calling each of us to be Desmond in some ways, to be the answer to the question that we're asking or the problems we're looking to God, that God will give us what we need. He'll give us the strength and the courage. I think sometimes we confuse what it means to pick up our cross. Picking up our cross, I think, is just what God is asking us to do in this parable. That we are called to listen to what God is asking us to do, to be the answer to our own prayers or somebody else's prayer. You know, sometimes we forget that God will give us what we need to be that answer. See, I don't think Christianity is meant to be an easy chair to live your life, and I think we've heard that before. Our faith is, and I don't believe our faith really is faith if we only remain whole, or we only have our faith if God is answering all our requests. I've heard that so many times, folks. I've been praying. I've lost my faith. God isn't answering. See, I think we have to get rid of that vending machine in the sky attitude that we put this coin in or this one or no coin, just a token, and God's going to answer our prayer and it's just going to happen. That I have prayed faithfully. But see, the truthful is if you, and any of you, if we lift a prayer up to God and say, "God, this is what I need. This is exactly what I see in the world. This is the justice I seek and want and right now." And we're saying, "God, you got to do this or else my faith is going to disappear." Basically, what we're doing is we're playing God. We're saying to God that we can see better than you can. See, the Apostle Paul says it in a different way. He says, "But now you see dimly in the mirror that one day, like I see you fully." See, right now, do we see the whole world? Do we know the beginning of creation to the end of the creation? Who does? God. And we need to either trust that's our faith, or we don't. See, we all know Psalms 23. "He guides me in the paths of his righteousness for his name's sake. He restores my soul," right before that. See, he doesn't promise that he's going to restore my fortunes. That's not part of Psalms 23. He doesn't say he's going to restore my body to the way it was, or a marriage to be that perfect marriage. He doesn't say any of this. In fact, the psalmist doesn't say that he's going to limit any of your troubles or your hardships, but that even in the valley of the shadow of death, I will be with you. That's what the psalmist says. That's what prayer is about. Prayer is about you talking to the one that you know will be with you in all situations. See, as I started earlier, I've had people come to me and talk to me both here and outside. I've prayed and I prayed and there's nothing been changed. My job still stinks. But I've been praying about that new job and nothing's happening. So I'm not going to pray anymore. Actually, I don't have faith and I'm not even going to come to church anymore. It's useless. I've lost my faith. Or my life stinks. All these bad things keep happening. Or husband or wife, they're not changing the way I want them to be. And I've been praying and God's not answering my prayer. Or a child that's sick. And I hear that every once in a while. My child is still sick. Prayer doesn't seem to matter. I'm not sure if I have the faith. And I've had one person actually say, I believe it's you, pointing to me. And I always try to tell them, I'm not God. You know, but they blame the church. Evidently, this church doesn't have enough faith to make my wants and desires to come true. That's the reality. And they get mad at me. And I praise God that they do. Better me than somebody else. Because I will still love. See, we may find ourselves with that wish list, that demand list, that wish that says, God, I'm desperate. You know, we hear about those, right? Those times when say, God, I'm desperate. Fix it. Make it work out for me, O Lord. I've prayed that before. And this is what I need, Lord. And I do my list. And dang gummit, a lot of times it doesn't work out that way. But when we approach prayer this way, when we give God the orders, you know what? We may not be letting ourselves actually hear what God is answering for us. See, we already have our mind made up, and we don't hear what God may be telling us. He may be telling us, we are the problem. Let me help you correct it. These are the steps that I can show you in this word to help make things different. God may have a different job for us to do, a new cross to bear in our grievances, but we're so mindset that we already know what we need, we don't see the big picture, that we lose what God really is trying to help us with. He may point out the why to us, why this is happening to us in our life, the choices that we made that were bad, the choices we're still making bad, or the lack of commitment or dedication to follow completely. Like many things God tells me, I've always had a problem with prayer. I know you guys are saying, what are you talking about? Problem with prayer. See, prayer does not make sense to me in some ways if we read Scripture. Why do I have to tell God everything He already knows? Right? God already knows it before we... That's what Scripture says? So why do I have to tell? This morning I got called to the hospital to pray for a gentleman named Bob who was on his journey home, and his family was there. And I started the family gathered, and I started the prayer as I do a lot of times with saying, you know, Father, Bob's family and I surround your child with love right now. And we ask for your presence to be here. We ask for your grace and blessings to be upon his journey. But Lord, we are open for a miracle if you want to show us one. But Lord, and I go on with that. And, you know, I know God already knows what's going on. You know, I don't think after I said that, God all of a sudden's up in heaven and goes, holy smokes, I didn't know Bob was in trouble. Peter, where's Carl at it? What hospital is he at? See, I don't think that happens. I don't know if you guys do. Nevertheless, I pray. Nevertheless, I pray, even though I know God already knows what I need. Not what I want, but what I need and what the people need. And I pray not only because the Bible tells me to, but because out of my faith, I am drawn to prayer. It makes me feel good. It makes me feel whole. Prayer stabilizes me in times that I didn't think I could be stabilized. It keeps me calm overall, compared to what I was. It cares for my soul. It kind of balances it in the times when I'm really weary or in times of trouble. Prayer somehow comforts me and encourages me when I'm, you know, that weeble wobble, but they don't fall down. When I'm wobbling, God comforts me and kind of stabilizes and encourages me to keep on going. Sometimes I feel dead in spirit. Anybody ever been like that? But prayer kind of restores that soul. Sometimes I pray because I just need to talk to Him. And I've had people say to me that, and Dan Moore said this once and I loved it, that we use Jesus as a crutch. But I've had people say to me that, oh, you pray, and you Christians, you pray because you can't face the realities of life. And I always say, yep, of course, that is why I pray. You got it right on the money. And I always tell them, but the time will come when you're going to want to talk to somebody. You know, what's that old thing? There's God's always in the foxhole or something like that. You know, there's a time that, and I said to the people, this is the good news, though. When you're ready, he's going to be there. He's not going to let you down. God will be there to carry them through the valley of the shadow of death at that very moment. Jesus is telling us in this passage, in this parable, that out of faith, we need to keep praying. We need to keep talking. We need never to give up and never to lose heart. There are times in life that made me question in my own life, who's in charge? You know, that's that joke about, you know, when you think you got it right, God laughs or does something and he's laughing, you know. Sometimes I've seen that. In times when I see there's no way out, there's no path to the power that I need to get through the mess that I'm in, that we actually, I have found out in my life that that's when I have the most power. When I think I have no power to do anything, that's when the most power comes to me in my faith. Because I can call upon God in faith. In faith. With the belief that it doesn't matter what I see or what I'm experiencing, I know that in my faith that I cannot see the whole picture. I don't know why bad things happen to good people. I don't know why good things happen to bad people. But that's not my worry. That's God's problem. My problem is to be faithful, to keep on praying, to keep on showing people that impossibilities can happen. See, we don't see the whole picture as God, our Creator, does. He has promised us an unending love that will not stop. He has told us over and over again in Scripture that he's the one in charge, but we fight it. And he will be the one that will bring about justice in the end to all his children. But we want it now. And that becomes a faith issue. Basically, the faith isn't about God. God is being honest and telling us from the beginning. The faith issue is us. I want to be God. And if I'm not God, I'm not going to trust anybody else. That's the bottom line, folks. And so we sometimes get prayer so messed up. It's not a request machine. It is a communication so you can feel the comfort, that you can have the assurance that he is with us, that his plan is bigger than ours. For me, this parable tells me that in all situations, we have the power to give God the gift of our faith. You know, I never looked at it really that way until I really started praying about this, that we can give God a gift, and that's our faith and our trust. And that's what Jesus Christ asked us to do throughout the Scripture. But in this passage especially, he is saying no matter what circumstances we find ourselves in, keep talking to God. Keep praying. You may not see the answer, but it is making a difference. But you need to be consistent. You need to be persistent. You need to have knowledge that God is there. Because he tells us that. This passage is about our faith. And Jesus puts that zinger at the end. Will you have faith when I return? That's a tough question, isn't it? Do you trust him 100%? Be careful, don't answer that, because he'll bite you back, trust me. See, God loves you enough to give you tough, tough parables to chew on. It's not a parable about how God and the judge are like. They can't be more opposite. But it is a parable about how we can be like the widow and live our faith even when things do not seem to be going right. That's the story, and that's what we have to do to show God our faith. For there's no end in those who trust in him. Amen. If you join me, I don't know what the last hymn is, but it's on hymn number 25. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. First and fourth verse. Seated. What is faith? What is faith? It's working and living and believing in what we do not see. That is prayer. God is telling us that we need to keep praying, keep talking to Him, even if we don't see the answers at this time, because He knows the answer for further down. And the question is, do we trust that? Do we trust that God knows more than we do? The answer is yes. And so, because we do not see our prayers being answered, has nothing to do with faith. Faith has everything to do with continuing to pray, even though we don't see the answers. Okay? It goes one way, but not the other way back. See, that's what this parable is about. Remaining faithful in prayer. Not getting what you want, but are receiving what you needed. As Habakkuk says, we have been forgiven. Praise the Lord. There is no end in those who believe in Him. Amen. Peace and the love of Jesus Christ. And I remind you, downstairs is coffee fellowship. And if you would like to sign up for being one of the cars at the trunk or treat, we could use the cars. So talk to one of us. Thank you. I forgot to get the sign up.